Okay, let's get going with part two, which I'm expecting will run not to the full time, I'm hoping, because I want some time for questions near the end, if possible. Okay, so we'll just have to see how we get it. It might be, I have a tendency to go wrong. Okay. So, who's this guy? Anybody got any idea who this mild-mannered crusader is?
He's a bit of a pessimist.
He's a bit of a pessimist, you can say that. A little bit more, isn't he? He's a little bit of a pessimist. He's a contrarian, actually. Okay, anybody know? So this guy's name is Ted Nelson. Has anybody heard of Ted Nelson? Oh, a bit of a recognition there. No? Ted Nelson, no? Okay, so Ted Nelson is the guy who invented hypertext. Invented the term hypertext, invented the concept of how hypertext works, and he invented how the linking should work. He also thinks that the web is a pile of old pants and we shouldn't be using it because it's not his vision of hypertext. Okay? If you want to look at some of the work he's done, or some of his concepts, then you need to look at various bits of work called Xanadu, okay, or Zigzag. So these two things, Xanadu and Zigzag, allow for this kind of interlinking of documentation over the web, but in a very different way than the Google World. Okay? But his work is really the foundation for what we now know as the web. And his site has been credited by Tim Berners-Lee, who, as you know, invented the web, or at least this, as being one of the main reasons why, as being one of the main influences on it. Okay. So, he's got a famous quote. I hope nobody's particularly offended by famous quotes, but he thinks, most people think, most authority is mine, God does not exist, and everything is wrong. Okay? Now, the last part, and some of the others may be very good for you to think about as user experience people, okay? Everything is wrong. You need to start to question the facts you're told, the data you're given, the papers you've been told to read by me and anybody else, and the news and everything else. Okay, mostly, everything is not quite right. Okay, it might not be wrong directly, but it's maybe not as you've expected to be. Okay, so this is something you really need to think of in user experience. If you don't think about it in user experience, then you're going to have developments that look as though they're good, that look as though they can work with people, but actually won't. Okay. So, anybody know Jacob Nielsen? Anybody know the work of Jacob Nielsen? Yes? Okay, good.
Is it Don't Make Me Think?
Yeah, Don't Make Me Think is, not Jacob Nielsen, but it's the same. It's in the same domain. Usability, okay? He's a usability guy. And he's a very famous usability guy in practical usability circles, and he's part of this Nelson Norman group. And he's been doing HCI and usability for years and years. One of his famous papers that he wrote was a paper about how five users, you can do a usability study with five users. Okay? And that usability study with five users has now been taken on by usability experts the world over. The reality is that he never said that, and it's wrong. Okay? So, when you're told your work can do a study with five users, you can't. And he never said you could. What he said was, you can get 80% of the errors by looking at five users on a very specific task, one task only. So if you think that in a word processing application, there's hundreds of tasks, you need five times hundreds of users to be able to get all of the 80% for each task that you're going to execute. Okay. But, because people want to believe that they can do a usability study with five users and they'll get proper results, they'll get results that mean something to people, everybody wants to quote it because it's cheaper. Okay, so yeah, we can do it with five users. The reality is that you can't, and the empirical evidence is on this chart to the right hand side. So this work is done by Fulmer. Now, while I'm talking, let me just point you to page, is it on page 37? Page 37. So if you look on page 37, there's two references, one to Laura Faulkner and one to Jacob Nielsen.
and their references are thereafter referred in the text. Swap those references, it's a typo. Okay? So Laura Faulkner should be reference 43 and Jakob Nielsen should be reference 42. Okay? Okay, so Laura Faulkner did a lot of work and she meta-analysed a number of usability studies. And she found that when you look at the number of errors that are picked up in these usability studies, even for single tasks, you can't do it. You know, you just can't do it. So here you can see a set of five users, you're getting people at 55%. These are we're only finding half of all the usability errors. Okay? Then if we increase it to 10, you find you can, well, it's about 80. Okay, but still not brilliant. Still there's 20% of errors that go that are just out there, that go unseen. Okay? And that's a problem. I mean, there'd be no in statistical analysis, there'd be no statistical significance there. Now, 15, better. Set of 15 users, much better. Set of 20 users, better still. Okay. Here, there's far more recall than there is precision. Do you know precision and recall? Yeah? So here there's far more recall than there is precision. Here you've got good recall and precision. Okay? Reasonable. This is far superior to his bottom two. But this is still only 15 users on one definite task, not an entire application. Yeah? So that's an error. But the usability community keep liking this five users. So when somebody tells you in your user experience job, oh, we can do it five users, you know to tell them, you can't. Okay? Moon orbits the Earth. Everyone knows that, surely. Moon orbits the Earth, doesn't it? Any ideas why that might not be right? Does the moon really orbit the Earth? It just spins? No, it doesn't orbit in that way, yes.
It orbits the centre of gravity of the Earth.
Absolutely right. Yes. So the moon orbits the centre of gravity of the two, which is very, very similar to the centre of the Earth, but it's not exactly the centre of the Earth. Okay? So we all think the moon orbits the Earth, but it doesn't. It orbits the centre of gravity, the combined centre of gravity of both. That's something that made us tell that down the book tonight and say, oh, I was in the UX lecture, we're getting a beer down here. Yes?
If we're going over to that, then technically doesn't it also orbit the combined centre of gravity of the moon, the Earth and the Sun?
Yes. Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a certain level of the thing with all of this stuff is that the problem arises when the level of detail has been abstracted away such that fact becomes only that. Okay. If we still have that level of detail in there, that's right. So you're right. I mean, and obviously gravity for everything has an interplay for the entire galaxy, for the entire universe has an interplay. Okay. Next one. Blind people can't see, obviously. Is that obvious? Can blind people see? Or not? Or are they all blind?
Depends on the level of blindness.
Pardon? Depends on the level of blindness. Good, good. Yeah.
And can also use like sounds and see. If you can't see in sort of having a view of the space around them, then.
Perception of the space around them, yeah, that's one thing. Anybody else? Okay, well, you're right, there are levels. Actually, blindness isn't a definitive term directly. So blindness, say for the World Health Organization, is the ability to see things at 3 feet. Okay? Now, therefore you're technically blind. Profoundly blind people who can't see anything, only represent 4% of the total population of blind people. Okay? So 96% of blind people can see something. It may be very blurry, but it is very blurry and it is shadows, there might be colours that they can see, that people who are blind can see. There's very few people who are profoundly blind. So when you're building something, you need maybe to take that into account in your interface design. Do you not? Maybe that you want to make sure that the screen can be magnified very large and it still maintains its cohesion. Maybe you want to make sure that maybe you could communicate by some kind of different kinds of colours. Okay, as well. So that colour changes are very perceived by some people who are blind. Okay? So you need to think about these things when you're creating your interfaces too. Blind people can't see. Got some almost all brains have the same organisation. Okay, so all of our brains are the same. We've got the visual cortex, the auditory cortex, cerebellum, all that kind of stuff. It's all there. You're shaking your head. You look like a Renaissance man. You know what I mean?
Well, the brains that there is neurons that are all organised differently. If they're all the same, then they're all effectively the same person.
Okay, so that's a good, that's, I like that level of detail, excellent. And a bit, any more than that? So say the auditory cortex, yes?
Well, I read articles, I don't know how true it is, but someone had the nerve between the hemisphere from one hemisphere to the brain, to the other, severed, so one of the hemispheres affected the guy.
Yeah.
And they found that one hemisphere actually taking on the function of the other one to die.
Yes,
so
yes.
It can't, like, it's clearly very adaptive, so it can't possibly have the same organization between people.
That's right. Okay, so the brain is super adaptive, okay? Especially up to the age of 21. This thing that you're talking about is called neuroplasticity. Okay, and so neuroplasticity is something whereby our brains are able to repurpose aspects which aren't used. So for instance, for people who are profoundly blind, say, and they go profoundly blind before the age of 21, then their brains, the visual cortex is repurposed for auditory and tactile often. Okay? So there's no more auditory cortex left. It's just looking at tactile and it's looking at auditory, it's receiving auditory and tactile. Okay? Sometimes it gives you an enhanced memory. Other aspects are still there. So certainly within memory, other aspects are still there. So for instance, if you are told to close your eyes and visualise something, areas of your visual cortex will light up, even though you're not using vision. Okay? When we look at this in PET scans. Okay? So all of this kind of stuff means that we all think, or lots of people think, I'm glad to see that you guys are thinking slightly differently, brains have the same organisation, you know, auditory cortex, visual cortex, all that kind of stuff, but they don't. Okay. Vision is parallel, hearing is circular. Okay? Who believes that to be the case? Nobody believes it to be the case. You're all gods of people, that's what I'm saying.
In what way do you believe? Huh? In what way, in what stage of...
So for instance, can we hear, okay, so let's say we get beyond this point, whereby we think of a sound wave, and how we combine two sound waves and they come out to kind of thing, got this Fourier transform job, so yeah, forget about that, forget about the sound wave actually going into your ear, but once it gets into your ear, is it serial or is it parallel? Most people, as far as the people that, most people, believe it's serial, whereas vision, it's parallel because we can see lots of things all at the same time. No?
I was talking about, like, how you can focus on one thing at once in hearing.
That's one point. Yeah? Any more? So the thing is that hearing is not serial, and the reason why it's not serial is because the cochlea has the thing called the basal membrane, and the basal membrane is like a graphic equalizer with a different neuron for each different sound, okay, frequency. And those all react together to any particular sound. So they send a parallel sound signal up the neuron, through what's called the olive, which joins the left and right hemispheres, and then into the auditory cortex. And the auditory cortex processes in parallel, we think, in parallel, different frequencies of sound all the way. Okay? So that's why you might be able to hear things in, say, it's a famous thing called the cocktail party problem, which is by a guy called Cho. In the 1950s, where he's interested in understanding the different ways that we can actually interact at cocktail parties and how the sound works. So obviously we can hear multiple things going on at the same time. Yeah. Okay. But if you ask most people, go out in the street and ask most people. Oh, it's fine. Now, here's one. Something for you to see. So, I want you to do, has anybody seen this before? Count the number of times. Okay. Well, all of you can shut up. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else know the answer to this? If you know the answer, don't look or don't shout it out, because I want the learning experience to occur.
This is a test of selective attention. Count how many times the players were and what passed the basketball. How many passes did you count?
Ooh, so, how many passes did you count? Oh, by the experience. 15 passes. Okay, did we all count those passes? And everybody, in, what else did everybody see?
Ben.
Drilla. 16. Okay.
15 passes. But did you see the gorilla?
So this gorilla, when you see it, 80% of the population do not see the gorilla. Okay, so 80% of people don't see that gorilla. And there's a number of other ones where they where the gorilla's moonwalking. And,
this video is
doing
from Search by Dan Simons and Christopher Chabrie, and is copyrighted. It is available for use in talks, training, and teaching on DVDs from Visible.
Okay, so the thing with this is that most people don't actually see that. The vast majority don't see the gorilla. Because they're so bothered with their selective and directed attention on one thing, their focus is on one thing. That's something we also have to be wary of. When we're asking people to do something and their focus becomes changed to that particular thing, focused on that particular thing we're asking them to do, then we start to miss lots of other stuff. And that means we don't have something called situational awareness. And situational awareness is important in usability, to understand where we are and how we can get from the next place. It's also very useful in, it's big in flight decks, flight control systems, for pilots, that kind of thing. Situational awareness is really important. Okay. So, the upshot of this is to think of these simple things. Be curious, be critical. Now, Coca-Cola invested loads of money in changing their Coke, okay, their brand of Coke. They wanted the new cool brand of Coke used with, it's created with various people, okay, it's a whole new recipe for Coke. And they went out to do consumer tests with this Coke, and hardly anybody bought it when they released it. Everybody said they loved it, everybody said it was brilliant, the best new Coke there could be, and nobody liked it. In fact, people in America, certainly on the West Coast, used to take a truck down to Mexico where they still have the old Coke, and buy a truck of old Coke from Mexico to bring back. I'm betting those guys could.
Was that a Coke?
No, that was real, it was Coca-Cola, it's just made differently. And it wasn't the air.
Well, this is when you said Mexico.
Not that kind of Coke. These are computer scientists, I'm sure, doing this. Anyway, hardly anybody bought the original Coke. So, why is that?
Yeah.
What's the reason for that? Yes?
When people fill in surveys, they're afraid to put what you really think, especially if they're talking to a person.
Right, so when people put through surveys, they're very afraid to put what they really think. This is called experimental bias. Okay. Yes?
There's nothing wrong with the old Coke.
There's nothing wrong with the old Coke. Well, probably more expensive to make from Coca-Cola's point of view, but yes, I agree.
People don't like change for change's sake.
People don't like change for change's sake. That's also very true. But would that motivate you to actually go all the way to Mexico?
No, maybe.
Okay, maybe. Yes?
Did they change the packaging of the very, was it slightly different to like the original Coke?
No, it wasn't.
Was that just
like
identical?
Yeah. So obviously, it tastes like.
Yes, it tastes different. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say about branding and marketing as well, saying that they changed the marketing approach. Is that a new and improved flavour of the
product? No, I mean, yes, they very well might have said new and improved flavour, but the actual branding itself wasn't significantly different from the original. One thing that comes back to this experimental bias is, in the questionnaire, people will often give, what's that TV show with the crotchety medical dude? House. House's famous thing is, everybody lies. And on surveys, everybody lies. Okay, on face-to-face interviews, everybody lies. Or they tell you what they think you want to hear. Now, in these taste tests, you've got they perform a set of taste tests. So generally, they've got Coke in one container. The new Coke in another container. And then they said, right, taste, which tastes better? Why, on a taste test, how could there be any bias? Anybody? It's because there's this idea of experimental bias, there's imperceptible bias, okay? So for instance, if I know that this is good Coke, and this is, or this is the Coke we want to start marketing, and this is old Coke, the Coke we want to get rid of. And you start to go for the old Coke, or you start to say, well, I think it's, and you go like this, I as the experiment may draw away, I may twitch, I may make some body movement, which biases the outcome, because then the person suddenly changes their what they want to actually pick. Because they can, it's imperceptible, but you can sense what an experimenter wants the outcome to be oftentimes. That's why we have things called double blind trials. Does anybody know what a double blind trial is?
It's when people do a trial don't know either.
Yes. It's when people who are doing the trial don't know either. They don't know which is good, which is bad, which they should pick and which they shouldn't pick. So therefore you can be very sure that it's not the experimenter getting in the way. Yes, you're right.
Is it also the fact that some people think this is the new product, so it must be better?
Some people don't like change, some people like novelty. So there's all those factors to contend with. Also, there's triple blind trials, whereby the person who's doing the analysis of the actual data that's coming back also doesn't know what the desired outcome is. So they can't influence the statistical test either, so they just give the stats that they think. Yeah? Yes?
Also, due to the market penetration of the old code, testers would know that that's the old code straight away.
Yeah, that's true. That's another thing. But so in those tests, even if they could taste, this is old Coke, this is a different kind of Coke, you'd expect them, some people like novelty, but most people like change, then they're going to say, oh, I ought to be thinking, yes, I want the old Coke. Unless they know that they want the new Coke to be, obviously if you're testing old against new, it's implicit that new is good. Should be the one you're choosing. So you've got to think of all these things. Other things that you might, other influences that might happen, and all these influences are what's known in psychology, and this kind of work is called confounding factors, okay, or confounding variables. Okay. Now, people were receiving information on the impact of their energy consumption on the environment, and also how much these things were costing. And it was predicted that if they were given more information about the costs and the benefits, that they'd use less. And in reality, it's they used more. Okay? They thought, perception, they thought they were using more anyway. So generally, as soon as they were told, well, actually, you know, this costs less, you're using less, or this is the impact, then they started to use more because they thought the environmental impact was more significant than it actually was. Okay? But what do you think? Influence them to stop doing that, to actually be better environmentalists, or to have a better energy consumption. What influenced them? Peer pressure. Generally, all they were told is, oh, your neighbours are doing this, and then they just did whatever their neighbours did. Okay, so if they said, oh, your neighbours are really making headway on this, and they've got a much reduced energy bill, everybody else's energy bill won't go up. Because even if there was no neighbours originally that were making this change. Yeah? So all of the energy bills went down because of this. Yeah? But it was originally dismissed. Psychology said, oh that would be influential. No. But it was. It was the most influential. Okay. So that comes back to it. Be curious and be critical in the user experience. Make sure that you want to understand what's happening, understand what's going on, understand the interactions between people, understand how they tick. Okay? But also be super critical. Yeah? Be super critical about it. Okay. Anybody know who this mild-mannered chap looks like? Who is he? Anybody got any ideas? No? These old dudes? Yes?
Some who invented the heuristics?
No? Didn't invent heuristics, no? So this guy's called Vannevar Bush. What a great name. Vannevar Bush. Anyway, he's called Vannevar Bush now. Vannevar Bush. Anybody got any ideas about Vannevar Bush? So, people in HCI in the old days, and there's a very nice 2010 edition of Interacting with Computers which talks about this, the evolution of HCI. HCI comes from multiple different disciplines. Human computer interaction comes from multiple different disciplines, of which user experience is one particular part. Okay. Now, the discipline disciplines that HCI comes from are psychology, sociology, anthropology, and computer science, mainly computer science, and oftentimes. But this smushing up of different kinds of research from different domains means that there's no definitive idea about HCI and its origins directly. Okay, so this you should know is my, if you like, origins of HCI, and most people who are computer scientists and technicals, origins of HCI. Okay, so this guy, Vannevar Bush, wrote a paper, As We May Think, it's called, 1948. And he wrote this paper for the Atlantic Review, the Atlantic Quarterly. And his idea was that the mind operates by association. Now, you might be thinking to yourself, well, yeah, that's kind of obvious, we know everything about that. The reality is that in the old days, 1948, yeah, okay, we thought along the lines of indexes. If we wanted to find information, if we wanted to find knowledge, if we wanted to do searches, it would be by an index. And we have to make sure that everything was indexes. The Dewey Decimal System was one such indexing method, yeah. Okay, so the human mind operates by association was something that we didn't really think of, that we shouldn't be looking for things in microfiche films, in standard catalogues indexes. We shouldn't be looking for things in this kind of linear way, because our brains don't operate linearly. We should be looking for things by association of what they're associated to, okay, just like our brains do. So this guy created this conceptual system called the MEMEX, and the MEMEX is the prototype for the web and for Ted Nelson's